Good afternoon, Mohan ma'am.
Good afternoon, Sonali. Good afternoon.
Ma'am, may we begin?
Yeah, good afternoon, Veera. Good afternoon. Just a moment, Sonali ma'am.
Right. In the meanwhile, I request all the panelists to please turn on their cameras.
Good afternoon, Veera ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. Welcome to Amity Push VR on our Teams. Pleasure to have you all. I think Sonali ma'am, we can start now.
Right ma'am, thank you so much. Insomnia is a common sleep disorder that can make it hard to fall asleep, hard to stay asleep, or cause you to wake up too early and not be able to get back to sleep. You may still feel tired when you wake up. Insomnia can sap not only your energy level and mood, but also your health, work, performance, and quality of life. Very good afternoon, everyone. I, on behalf of Amity International School Post Vihar, welcome all of you to the panel discussion of Team Nindya, the youth power team of Amity International School Post Vihar. Before we begin, let's express our gratitude to the Almighty and light the lamp of knowledge. I request everyone to please join their hands and close their eyes. Thank you. I express my heartfelt gratitude to our ever revered chairperson, ma'am, Dr. Mrs. Amita Chauhan, ma'am, who wants each of her Amitian to become a change maker and own up for the country. Every year, students take up numerous issues and bring tangible change in the society. And all the credit goes to our chairperson, ma'am, who believes and instills these skills in the students, her Amitians. Youth Power is a program under the newspaper for the students, of the students, by the students. Global Times, the brainchild of our respected chairperson, ma'am. And we are elated to have amongst us the managing editor of the Global Times, Ms. Veera Sharma, ma'am, to witness this discussion today. We welcome you, ma'am. We also express our heartfelt gratitude to the support system behind it all, our respected principal, ma'am, Mrs. Amita Mohan, ma'am. Her constant encouragement and support is what makes us win laurels in Youth Power every year. I welcome Dr. Manveer Bhatia, a renowned neurologist and sleep specialist. She's a senior neurologist and sleep specialist with more than 25 years of experience. She's the director of Neurology Sleep Center, New Delhi. She's currently the vice president of the Indian Society for Sleep Research. She's the author of the book, The Sleep Solution, the first nonfiction book on sleep in India. I heartily welcome you, ma'am. Thank you for taking our time for us. I also would like to welcome Dr. Jayakumar Christie. He's presently the associate professor in the Center for Psychosocial Support in Nimmons Institute. He has over 21 years of experience in handling psychosocial care issues and mental health across the country. He's former senior specialist for psychological support and mental health services in disasters at NDMA. Thank you so much, sir, for taking out time for our students. Last but not the least, as our panelists, we have Ms. Shefali A. Bhardwaj. She's a senior manager at PVR Limited with a total work experience of over 17 years. She's worked with top management companies like Max, Bupa and Yes Bank. She did not let insomnia come in the way of dreaming big. Thank you so much, Shefali ma'am, for taking out time. As part of the Amity tradition, we give a virtual sapling to each one of you and welcome you here. And I request Mohan ma'am to please give a formal word of welcome to all of our guests.
I think for all my guests, this sapling of Tulsi plant will bring prosperity, peace. And this is a tradition that has been followed in Amity for many years. I think, Sonali ma'am, we can send it across to all their houses also.
Absolutely.
So let's find out. We are really honored and privileged to have all of you amongst us today. And I think my Youth Power team has always been working on topics which are very close to everyone's heart. And I think a chairperson ma'am says that these are the students who are the change makers for the society. I mean, this year when they took up Nindya, especially in the COVID times, this was something which is really asked for. Because of all the patterns being changed, this became the topmost thought in the minds of the parents and was affecting the health of the children. I think I'm very proud of my Nindya team. In fact, chairperson ma'am was saying ki nindya aise to nahi lag raha ki koi ninda na kar raha hu. Main kehne ma'am wo neend se uthaya hai unhone aur neend jo ki bachcho ko bahut pyari hoti hai. And I think Nindya team, you've been doing wonders and you've been doing great. Veera, I'm sure you must have had panel discussions of all the global time, all the teams, and you would all obviously feel that each team is doing wonderfully in all their aspects, and I wish success to all the teams. And I think Global Times and Veera ma'am and Bhavna, you've been doing a great job for providing the opportunities, giving ideas, working with the team. Thank you so much, and thank you Dr. Manveer Bhatia, thank you Jaykumar ji and Shefali ji for being here for my children and for helping us to work on the proper path to help out the children. Welcome once again. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
I now hand over the mic to Kavin and Suhani, who will now take over for their questions with our guests and will help us learn a lot from their expertise. Kavin and Suhani, over to you.
Right. Thank you so much, ma'am. I'd like to wish all our panelists a very warm welcome again. I'd begin with the questions, and my first one is for Dr. Manveer Bhatia. Again, thank you so much for being here, ma'am. My question to you is, how easily diagnosable is insomnia? And in your experience, have you ever had patients who've come to you unknowing about insomnia or unknowing that they might even have insomnia?
So insomnia, as was first mentioned, it is a subjective complaint. And we have now guidelines like we have for everything, that how should one diagnose this condition. So firstly, it has to fulfill these criteria, which are that you have difficulty in falling asleep, staying asleep, waking up early, or overall non-refreshed or unrefreshed sleep. But along with this, there are daytime symptoms, such as mood changes, difficulty in concentration, headaches, body aches, etc. And then we have something called as frequency and duration. So all of us at some time or the other would have experienced a bad night, but that doesn't make that all of us have insomnia. So 3 times in a week for at least more than 3 months is what makes it now chronic, and less than that is acute or short-term insomnia. So insomnia is, let's say, fairly easy to diagnose, provided we know what questions to ask. And those questions have to be about the night and about the day. And then we ask frequency and duration. So that's the recent guidelines by the American Academy of Sleep Medicine, or the recent classification, as we say. Second question was that, do they know that they have insomnia or they don't know?
Self-diagnosing, basically, how appropriate is that, or how easily do you think, in your experience, people know that they have insomnia or not?
So I, with the advent or with the help of Google, with Dr. Google, I have lots of people coming to me and telling me that I think I have insomnia. So sometimes they are right, sometimes they are not right. But like I said, according to us, we have to fulfill the night and the day criteria. But lots of conditions or situations are which resemble insomnia. Like somebody sleeps at 4 a.m., wakes up at 12 noon or 1 p.m. So is that insomnia?
I won't say so.
You won't say so. So what is that? That's what the generation is doing these days.
Yeah, I'd say that's a trend, maybe.
So it's called as a delayed sleep cycle or a delayed sleep phase, we call it. That you kind of have pushed the day into the night and the night has gone into the day. So, you know, when we get towards the end, we can talk about this dimension. But overall, to put it simply, yes, insomnia is a clinical diagnosis. We don't really require much testing. But what we do require as a clinician is that when we see a patient, we do what is called as a 24-hour routine is what I do, or which we are all supposed to do, meaning that we have to ask. So when somebody comes and tells me that, you know, I get into bed and I can't sleep, so I need to know a lot more. I need to know completely about what time they went into bed, their consistency, weekdays, weekends, what is done in the daytime, how much caffeine, what's the exercise, etc. So it's a full 24-hour routine, which we get information and then we are able to help people.
Right. That's quite insightful, ma'am. Thank you so much. Sohani, I hand it over to you.
Yeah. So that was a wonderful answer. Thank you so much, ma'am. So now I'd like to pose my next question to Professor J. Kumar Christie and his co-panelist. Sir, as we all know, the COVID-19 pandemic has strongly affected our sleep cycle, as well as our mental health. We have seen numerous deaths of our families and friends. Even those who have suffered and recovered spent 14 days in isolation. So how do they recover their mental state of their health, as well as their sleep routine?
Yeah, thank you, Suhani, I think. Am I right, Suhani? Good afternoon, children, my co-panelists, the principal and respected chairperson of Amity School. I'm glad to connect with you from Bangalore. Along with me is Dr. Balashanti here. I just landed here from Delhi, so my voice is also actually a little bit of cold, so hope I'm audible. See, regarding your question, yes, of course, pandemic touched everyone, and children are one of the most affected here. and especially children who went into quarantine or affected, definitely had that feeling of loneliness, feeling of left alone, and not able to interact and see people whom they actually close. So these are all actually some of the things which came very prominently. And what we have been suggesting and advocating and handling clinically also, that they should be in touch with their near and dear one. And today, actually, that digital age, we are all actually having mobile phones or some amount of communication. And the second thing is that the maintaining the routine, you are simply away from your family and dear and near ones and not doing anything, that is actually going to have an impact on your functionality, because there is actually a decrease in your functionality. You are not doing your daily routines. So that actually that we were advocating that to be maintained. Maintenance of daily routine is one of the important aspects for a positive mental health. And also should have an adequate access to disease information. And today, like Dr. Saab said, we have a Google doctor and more infodemic is happening. And for any symptoms actually that we tend to attribute, actually we also tend to have the same sort of a thing. So somewhere actually that we have to put a certain sort of a amount of a boundary line to how much we need to actually access, how much we need to read, and how much we need to assimilate, take it inside. And that is also important. And there are actually a number of helplines are also available. For example, NIMHANS, this place is actually running in a pan-India helpline, which so far catered to more than 600 lakh population across the India in 13 languages. Around 600 mental health professionals are enlisted all over India. And we have a separate this one going on for the children also. And like Delhi and every other place, actually mental health professionals and they are doing that. So this children in quarantine, actually that these are all the four or five things actually importantly need to take. And also the avoid overscheduling. People tend to overschedule it. And like my previous panelist said, sleep should be a priority here. You are ideal inside. It doesn't mean that you should not do it anything. And so that is where actually that these are all some of the practical tips only. It's a commonsensical tips only. We are not actually talking about anything about rocket science in psychosocial care for the post-COVID affected children or any adult here. It's a very, very simple things actually that we need to take care of it. Anything to add, Shanti?
In addition to whatever Dr. Jayakumar was mentioning, I think it's very important to look at the relationship between stress and sleep. They are extremely connected. The more the stress one person faces, sleep gets definitely affected. And when sleep disturbances occur, their ability to cope with stress, the ability to conceptualize stress and handle it also gets affected. So because of this, it is a very, very symbiotic relationship. So as much as possible, because of the pandemic or any other stressor or any other traumatic life event, when one has to face it, it's important for us to handle them and cope with them effectively. Okay, so that's something that you need to remember.
Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, for your insightful views. And I'm going to pass the mic to Karan.
Right. So my next question is for Shefali, ma'am. What I'd like to ask you is your personal experiences, the factors in your specific case that you think. So essentially just your general experiences of insomnia. You're muted, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are.
Thank you so much, Kevin. So for my personal experience, I would like to tell you that when I started facing this insomnia thing, I was under a lot of stress, like rightly mentioned that these both things are totally related to each other. And I was having my professional stress and then stress in the family. So I used to lay down on time, like 10, 10:30. My son, I have a 10-year-old son, he used to sleep. And after 2-3 hours also, I was unable to go to sleep. I just thought that, okay, fine, let me give myself more time so that I can go at rest. But it wasn't happening. The only thing was the to-do list, which I had to do the next day, was always appearing in my mind. So I have to do this, I have to do that. All these things were running into my mind, not allowing me to sleep. Then I did some meditation as well. Heard two sleep stories. The sleep stories were getting finished. Then also I was finding myself that I'm awake. And many a times I saw sunrise in front of me, but I didn't go to sleep at all. So it was really disturbing. However, I then learned from this thing that what is missing in me, there must be something which I'm doing, which is not right, which is not allowing me to sleep. So what I learned was I was not trusting anyone to share my task list. I was looking for the perfection in everything. So then I learned that done is better than perfection. So I started doing things as it is, as far as much better as I could do, not looking for perfection, but just start doing it, and so that it goes off my mind. And I think that these kind of things really help me. Also trusting, like we say, be the change you want to see in others. So I started, as I wanted people to trust me, I started trusting them myself, like my husband. So he wanted to help me, but he couldn't help me because I was trusting him. I always wanted things to be like what I, how I wanted them. So then I simply started trusting everyone in my surroundings and started delegating things. So that also helped me. And then meditation helped me a lot. So these kind of things helped me. And then I think now I'm feeling much better myself.
That's great to hear, ma'am. That was a great personal experience. Thank you so much for sharing. Suhani, back to you.
Yeah. So my next question is to our principal, Mohan, ma'am. Ma'am, as a sufferer from sleeplessness yourself, what were your personal experiences with insomnia, and how did it affect people around you and yourself?
What was the first, sorry, Suhani, what was the first line? I couldn't hear, there was some network issue.
I said as a personal experience, sleeplessness as herself, what were your experiences with insomnia and how did it affect people around you?
See, as the head of the school, I had a lot of parents calling me up, a lot of teachers calling up, the stress of doing an online thing, preparing the PPTs, and the fear that there'll be a network glitches, all was running in the minds of the teachers a lot. And of course, students ours, because they were sitting at home, they were all getting addicted to Netflix, Prime Video, and sleeping late or not being able to sleep because now they got into that habit because they were so used to be on online that they just wanted to sleep but couldn't sleep. Because everybody, if they sleep at the right hours, as Shefali ma'am was also saying it, it does help, but there are times the stress also builds up onto it. Now, like the class 12 board exams, children who have already gone, they were under stress if they had to give the exam, COVID second wave was already going on, what will happen, about their admissions. There are a lot of things that I came across which led to people having sleepless nights. But I think my take, as the team's take has been, luckily we are all on the same page, the different activities that Shefali ma'am said, meditation helped. And I think I realized it that walking a lot in the evening, or a brisk walking, actually helped the children and the teachers too. to let go of that stress, because once when you're walking and you're just concentrating on walking, it helped them. That was my take in the, during the COVID times. And it was not that they had to do the walking in the market or in the mall. They had to do brisk walking in the park. Because many of teachers said that, okay, can we do some walking while we're going shopping for the malls? I said, no, it has to be done in a natural surroundings, because that will give you a lot of oxygen and let go of things that are working on your mind. So my take during the COVID periods and the problems that I heard from my students and my teachers and my parents, like some of the parents were very stressful. Mere beche ko to marks hi nahi aayenge, wo padhta hi nahi hai, wo to sara time games khelta rehta hai. I had to tell, let the parents know that you need to let go. You have to have faith. It will work out. And I think that's, as Manveer ma'am was also saying it, though initially these problems were not identified by people. They didn't know about it. But now with the technology and with the advancement in science and technology and in medicine, I think we have help around for everything. So I think that's what my take, Swani. I hope I was clear.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for your answer, ma'am. I'm going to pass it to Kavin now.
Right. My question again goes back to Dr. Manveer Bhatia. So now my question is about your book. You authored a book called The Sleep Solution, right? my question is about the highlights of the book, what you hope we should glean for the book, how it could be helpful for us.
So the book, I thought of writing the book a few years ago because in the practice, I felt that I was repeatedly emphasizing a few things. You know, people, to get good sleep, it's not a simple thing, that it's a normal thing which we are all born with, and then we kind of lose track on how to get a good sleep. So we need to relearn. But to need to relearn, you need to first understand sleep. Why is sleep important? Why is there so much talk about sleep? What happens if we don't sleep? I mean, though the person who's not sleeping well has experienced whatever I'm going to say. But to improve the sleep, I felt that it's a self-help kind of a technique. So we need to first understand something. It's not in any way in this current scenario that we are in, whether it is adolescents or whether it is adults or elderly, you cannot just tell people, do this, 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 this. Nobody will follow it unless they have a why. So this book is very simply written. It actually can be read by all ages. It can probably be finished in over an hour and a half. But the chapters go exactly based on the answers that I was giving to everybody that I repeatedly saw, that what is sleep, what happens in our body in sleep, so what happens to the brain, what happens to your heart, what happens to your GIT, whatever happens, and then what happens if you don't get good sleep. And then came the chapters such as that, you know, can we measure sleep? And then came the things like common sleep disorders. And finally, the tips to improve your sleep. So again, this is the series of these tips are together called as something called as sleep hygiene. And there are a set of these rules or guidelines or principles which can help you get a good night. But for those who have persistent problems, who continue to have a bad night, who have a very bad day, cannot stay awake in class, interfering with their functioning, their scholastic performance, their moods, their emotions, we do want to emphasize that they should seek help. Like we seek help for somebody who has fever, who has headaches, we should seek help for emotional disturbances, cognitive impairments, I cannot learn, I can't concentrate, my brain is foggy, I open a book and I'm not able to look at things. So certain things like this, I feel they should be picked up early, addressed early. I have seen now adults actually who had sleep issues starting when they were children. But they said, yeah, it was there, but I managed. No, so you put all your energy and resources together to manage, but you could have been much better. So I think that, so the book is a very... A simple methodology or just a simple understanding of sleep, so that everybody at least gets to know what is happening in the body or the brain in sleep and why sleep is important. So it was a thought for many years that it's a passive process. Everything shuts down. You close your eyes, your brain shuts down, everything shuts down. Now we know it's the reverse, you know, so there's an active process going on in the brain. And for youngsters, just to say simply two sentences, there's like a cleaning up happening. So when you clean the junk, you make place for new memories. So imagine if you do this all-nighters, as you all call it. And the second thing which happens is consolidation. So whatever you have learned doesn't get cemented. Whatever junk had to be cleared doesn't get cleared. So the brain ultimately will, say the computer is shut down, the brain will shut down. So that's just one organ I'm talking about, because I focus a lot on neurology, and we now know that the cognitive concentration, attention, creativity is all linked to good sleep. And of course, you know, we have people from NIMHANS, but equal importance is mood. So teenagers are said to be lazy, angry, irritable. So we don't know whether they're all like this because they're just deprived of certain essential pillars of health.
Right. That answers our question, I think, really easily, very simply put, yet very intriguing too. Thank you so much for sharing that. Suhani, back to you.
Yes. So my next question is back to Professor Jay Kumar. Building on the points of our previous panelists, we've seen how school-going children and even college students and even most young adults have been feeling restless and facing sleeplessness during this time of pandemic. And this has caused their relationships and friendships to grow strained. Now they've been caged in the house for approximately 2 years. So how do you recommend they get over this fear of being alone and overcome their problems of sleeplessness?
See, like many of the things have been covered by the previous speakers, and one important aspect is that it is just not affecting the biological aspects of a person, and it also actually touches on very many aspects of your mental health, like mood, thought process, the ability to analyze and judge and interact. So it is actually coming on your other important domains of psychology, and even actually it is ultimately going into a social interaction also. I just came back from Delhi. So I was coming back, there was a lady who spoke to me, who came to know that I'm from NIMHANS. She just told me actually that her 18-year-old son most often actually glued to the mobile phone and iPad. And if we tell him actually not to overuse it, he gets very angry. He gets very agitated. He gets frustrated and she feels helpless. So it is just not actually about the problem of the individual or the student or the adolescent. It is also actually the parents or the caregivers and also the teachers. So it is actually going on at really at the multiple levels. So what is that we need to do it actually, that if somebody is actually, yes, last 2 years, everything has been changed. We are not the same people. Now we are actually all on the hybrid mode. We are not interacting. The usual physical activity is gone. And it's more of a mechanical and looking at each other through the screens. And so these are all actually definitely brought in enormous amount of stress. And the way we actually cope with the stress also changed. Today, the children are actually not only glued to the TV sets, but they're also overeating. They're also becoming more demanding. There are actually quarrels, frequent fights, and not listening to the parents, elders, and all those things actually are going into a sort of a thing. So the usual boundaries which we used to have, we used to go out morning to evening and come back. All of us actually used to have that schedule is gone. Everybody is actually there at home most of the time. And definitely, actually, it also actually brings in large amount of stress in the domain of interaction pattern. The family interaction pattern also actually changed. So there are, issues are coming at that level also. So it is going on like cognitive thought, behavior, interaction, and all those things. So for all this, it is not an individual, the family, the teachers, and everybody. So the reassuring the children is actually very important for the parents or the teachers also actually important. And educating age appropriateness, actually, that is also important. We just can't actually go and speak to the age like very scientific jargons or inappropriately actually we are talking certain information to certain age groups. So we need to actually maintain that appropriate ways of communicating with the children at home. And even actually we need to actually identify who are our support system, who actually we rely on something. I mean, the interaction is important. And maintaining the daily routine is important because, as I said, things have changed. And maintaining a safe distance and all these protocols are fine. Yes, it actually helps us to actually contain it, protect us, everything. But it is also actually coming with a more trauma in us. So we are not able to actually feel the same feeling actually which we used to feel before March 2020. And first and foremost is that acknowledging that something is actually not good. Everyone knows, but it is also actually understand actually that we are actually changing. There are actually certain changes are happening in our mind, in our thoughts, in our behaviors. So that actually needs to be, one should be aware of it. How one should be aware of it? Unless you interact with your dear and near ones, you interact with your parents or interacts with teachers or friends, you may not be actually aware of it. So that is actually that is very important. And the separation from the elderly or the teachers, so we are actually separated. I mean, digitally we are close, but physically we are separated. So somewhere actually that we need to actually keep that momentum going on, considering all the protocols which need to be followed. And also the use of media, social media, it is positive. It gives us enormous amount of education and awareness, but it also actually we need to put a brake on this. How much actually we need to use, how much we need to actually take the information, or how much information we need to take from an authentic source. That is where actually the cap we need to put it. So whether it is an individual, whether it is a parent, whether it is a teachers, all of us actually have certain responsibilities for our own health. At the end of the day, any disasters brings psychosocial stress, which goes into dysfunction and distress. Distress leads to dysfunction, and dysfunction leads to disorder. So if you are actually persistently having sleeplessness, definitely at the end of the day, it is going to come on your functionality, whether it is physical, whether it is cognitive, whether it is actually interaction everywhere. So, and later on, actually, it will escalate into some sort of a ill being. So, well-being is actually going to be affected, and it will move towards ill being. The sleeplessness definitely will take us actually to an ill being. So, all of us actually have to keep this momentum going, just simply following all those things. And screen time. And today, we are all actually having an enormous amount of screen time. So, that is what actually that we are actually advocating. We run a specific clinic called a Shut Clinic, that is for the digital detoxification of present generation. And definitely it is also actually one of the reasons which is actually affecting our sleep pattern, the circadian rhythm, which we call it. Actually, it's all changed. We used to follow a routine, now we are not following the routine. So how much actually we need to spend on the screen time also matters. So added to that, we have there are certain sleep hygiene, this one, and it is very, very simple only. We need to follow the sleep hygiene techniques and certain do's and don'ts. I think Shanti can actually add along with me.
All right. I think the question about loneliness, it is not very specific only to the younger generation and to children. Loneliness is a emotion, is a problem, difficulty, an issue which across developmental ages, all of us have faced, be it younger children or be it older adults in the family. So fear of loneliness, actually experiencing it or anticipating it was a big, big challenge during the COVID time because of social distancing, because of quarantine, etc., etc. So having said that, there are a few tips that people can easily follow because they are bound together inside the house and parents are working from home, children are studying from home, everything is literally virtual. Spending time with each other inside the family, doing rituals as a family together every day could help. Say, for example, eating together as a family, spending quality time together as a family, playing some board games together as a family could help in beating loneliness. Apart from that, spending virtual time together with friends, organizing virtual online parties with friends. I'm sure most of you have tried this during the lockdown times. So that is also a good tip that could help in beating loneliness. Taking up a hobby, taking up something new, a skill or a hobby, or learning a new language online again could help. Then again, maintaining a journal. This is something that we advise many of our own clients when we do online consultations with them. If there is nobody around them, apart from doing all these things virtually, they could also maintain a journal and see how their entire routine in a given day is spread out and how they can better this routine using a journal, and what are the different activities that are pegged inside their entire routine is something that they can note down in the journal. And along with that, what are the different emotions that they feel across the day is something that they can note down. This would give a lot of scope for reflection, and this would give a lot of scope for improvement in the way they perceive their entire day. Okay, so these could be some of the basic tips that can be followed to beat loneliness.
And one more important aspect is COVID pandemic is a global disaster. Any disaster, there is a stress. And these reactions, sleeplessness is actually one of the reactions, is a normal reaction to an abnormal situation. COVID pandemic is not, it doesn't happen on day-to-day basis. It is an abnormal situation. We all actually trying to adopt, trying to adjust, trying to actually get along well. So we must not feel that it is an abnormal sort of a reaction or a symptom. It is a normal response. We are actually trying to adapt to a changed situation.
Thank you so much for your answer. I think that actually suffices the question as a whole. So now I'll be passing it to Samaya.
Thank you. A very good afternoon, ma'am. This question is for Manveer, ma'am. Ma'am, my question for you is that as a researcher, what is an innovative practice discovered by you which has proven successful in the science and medical industry? Thank you, ma'am.
So, I don't know. The question is, what is something discovered by me?
Yes, ma'am.
If I had discovered something, I'd be filing patents. I think your questions are like, not very sure what you are trying to ask. So what I would say in simplified terms is the way that I have formulated a plan to evaluate patients clinically with sleep problems. And for us in the medical profession, that is called as history taking. So to understand the person's main problem, figure out why is it arising so that we can provide a solution. I think that's the way that I approach my patients. I do take the help of already well-known technology to understand sleep. So we have something called as tests, which are called as sleep studies, which is an overnight testing to get activity from the brain so we can understand a little more about the sleep quality, quantity, stages of sleep, etc. We can also understand their breathing patterns, the oxygen saturations, body movements, leg movements. So that is a resource which we use when we are handling patients. Thirdly, now there are a lot of these which you people also will know, or some of you must be using, are these trackers, which are called as just technologies, or you know, subjective kind of trackers which people are using, like the watches have trackers, etc. So people are coming forward and saying that, oh, you know, based on this, I'm not getting adequate sleep. This tells me my REM is less. So those are the things which have come into vogue recently. Where do they stand with the gold standards? They are not yet fully accurate, of course, but they are good guiding tools. And there are some people who have got particularly engaged with following up with these trackers and led to insomnia. And that's a term now called as orthosomnia. We also have a term called coronasomnia, which came up because of the corona. People developed a severe insomnia as a result of all the factors that we have discussed. So that's what I would say, is that each one of us develops our own tools and methodologies to try and evaluate or do best that we are doing. And for me, it has been the way that I can see or evaluate a patient, which can take almost 30 to 40 minutes with a sleep complaint or even longer sometimes. That what all have they done so far for this? Some people have done self-medication. Some people may have tried some substance to help. You know, all sorts of things are there. How much is there a psychiatric background? How much are these thoughts, these to-do lists, which go on and on? Either they can go in the beginning or they are waking up. I just saw somebody who's waking up every day at 4 a.m. with a thumping heart and profuse sweating and jerking and shouting. So lots of patterns have emerged, and we need to understand which patient, which student, which age group falls into which category. You know, sleeping off in school, these online classes, like we talked, somebody's mentioned the screen time. We have patients with migraines, with epilepsy. All those have increased because the screen times have considerably increased. But having said that, we have fixed hours of school, which we know. So beyond that, then you have to make an effort to go and play. And, you know, one of the faculty mentioned about walking. So walking has a lot of benefit for sleep. It's known to increase the deep sleep. It's known to improve continuity of sleep. But unfortunately, once we finish the work or the school on screen time, we again sit on the screen for the screens. So I think those are the kind of things. I will have to excuse myself now. I have actually some patients. I thought we will be here for 30 to 40 minutes and my time is done. I can end by saying just a few simple things, which I think that having looked at a lot of teenagers now during this time, even before, but now it's increased considerably. People pushed their, because when the complete lockdown happened, schools also closed. There was nothing online. Everybody just pushed their sleep times. In fact, large amount of research is showing that the adolescents slept about 2 hours later, but on the whole got more sleep. Because, and if you read wide surveys, teenagers are about 50 to 60% are deficient in the number of hours of sleep that they need. So I think the aim of your, this thrust that you're doing should be to promote good sleep amongst adolescents. That should be the message. Why is, of course, it will improve mental health, emotional health, physical health, and make you a much more better, happier, and a productive person. So that should be the kind of advocacy. What to do? There are those simple tips and tricks which you will find in most of the places it will be written. If you open up Google, it will give you all those 10 points. But I think 2-3 of them are really important. The first one being is fix your bedtime and your wake up time. So even with the schools opening, people are moving them back and forward on weekdays and weekends. I'm not saying why, because we don't have time, but the internal body clock, you confuse the body clock. Some days I want to sleep at 10, but some days I will sleep at 4. The days you sleep at 10, oh, I can't sleep. So what to do? Then I will take a pill. Or somebody in my house will say, okay, don't worry, I also take, you also take something. I've seen so many people doing this. Please do not take anything. So number one, fix the bedtime, wake up time. Adequate amount of physical activity is what we've stressed again and again. And some screen time, particularly before the bedtime, try and shut your screens off. Do something relaxing, whatever works. So meditation is good, but meditation is a big word. And there are numerous types of meditation. So people who are not familiar, please do not get scared or start. Everybody starts saying, oh, I'll do some meditation. It's not so easy to do. Even if you just do some deep breathing, it will relax your brain. You will activate your parasympathetic, shut down your fear and anxieties. You will feel calmer. So I think follow whatever you can. The other thing which has come up, a lot of research is saying that please do not make too many rules and regulations for yourself, because that itself is bringing on anxiety about sleep. So do whatever you can, do it naturally. Don't worry about it. It will come back. It's a natural process, but we need to make sure that sleep is a priority. And we need to understand that sleep is good for us. That's all that I want to say. And I will excuse myself, but it's been really nice interacting with everybody and listening to you all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Manveer, for being here with us today. We'll carry on with the discussion.
Good afternoon. So my question is for Ms. Shefali. Were your family and friends sensitive to your diagnosis, and how was the social reaction around you like? You're muted. We can't hear you.
Oh, I'm so sorry. So I want to say that it was a self-diagnosis. I never went to a doctor. Though I couldn't sleep the entire night, so I will call it insomnia. And about my... They always suggested me so many things. And I tried to help myself by doing whatever they had suggested me. I think being strong and being positive.
I don't require house. Got it. Thank you.
Hello. What was the question?
I'm sorry, Mr. Fali, your voice is breaking. Just a second. I think we can hear you now. Could you repeat your question, Zitin?
Yes, the question was that were your family and friends sensitive to your diagnosis, and how was the social interaction around you like, the reaction after your diagnosis?
I still didn't get the second one.
It means that how were people around you reacting after they got to know that you had insomnia?
No, they never knew about it. Only my family knew about it because it was a self-diagnosis. And so my family, immediate family only, and my friends only knew about it. Now it's not there. And about social things, so I never talked to anyone. So they never came to know also. Any difference in my behavior or something. It was just that I was always tired, not feeling fresh, and I started developing some pains in my joints and all. So not taking good decisions at that point of time. So this was the only impact. Otherwise, my immediate family, they were very supportive. And they used to suggest me a lot of things on their own. However, the two things which helped me were being strong and positivity. So I tried to diagnose the, the root cause of it, why I couldn't sleep. So like earlier also I mentioned that I wanted to do everything on my own, never trusting anyone else to finish the task. Then I started developing trust in others and started delegating my things and not following the perfection path. I started doing the things without looking for perfection. So these kind of things helped me.
Thank you so much for sharing your experience. I would like to hand it over to Samara now.
Yes, thank you. So my question is to Mohan ma'am. High school students nowadays have developed a trend to sleep late or not sleep at all. So what are your thoughts on that, ma'am?
So Mara, high school students, again, the voice was breaking. I'm so sorry. The network issue is really a problem. Sorry. Repeat again, Sumara.
Sure, ma'am. Was that high school students nowadays have a trend to sleep late or not sleep at all. So what are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts, obviously, Sumara, that they should sleep on time and not waste time. And I think as Dr. Manveer was also talking about, and other panelists were also speaking about it, it's a habit that needs to be formed. Now, to form a habit, you need to break the old traditions which you have set up for your own self. So children who are actually focused and motivated that they need to do something, because it is always said our old generation, older generation than mine also, my parents, that there's always a time for everything. And I think if all of the younger generation would take Akshay Kumar as their icon, he never goes for late parties, he never watches movies, he sleeps on time, he's up at 4 o'clock, going for gym, going doing physical exercises. If we have Bollywood stars to motivate our youngsters, and that's what the youngsters always look up for, some stars or role models for themselves. They just need to break. Habit, what does it say? It's in a bit, you need to break it to me. And habits only... Who forms those habits? Our mind forms them. Who's able to get free from those habits? We ourselves. So I think the senior secondary school students and younger generation also in the class 8, 9, 10th, 11, 12th, you just need to follow a certain routine. I know life becomes very boring. You can have one cheat day. One day you can watch, sleep late, get up late. I'm not expecting all of you to every day at 10:30. Okay, mom, good night, mom. No TV, no mobile, no WhatsApp, no YouTube. No. You can have one or two cheat days. The rest of the days, you must follow a certain strict pattern. And that will help you out. Actually, you know, at times when I work late and I sleep late myself, and there's certain things going on into my mind, and when I get up late, I feel guilty about the fact that the morning hours, which are so pure as far as the energy levels that are supposed to be very high, I miss on to that, and then I regret the whole day. And then, you know what I do? I punish myself by not eating the thing which I like the most. I say, today I did not follow the pattern of getting up early in the morning, so I must let go of things for which I'm very close to as far as eating habits are concerned. So I do that then. And I think if all of us can follow that pattern, it will be good enough for all of us. It's easier said than done, but if you want to do it, you will be able to do it. Good. Thank you, Samara.
Thank you, ma'am. So I'll pass it on to Sanchana now.
Thank you. So my question is to Professor Jaya Kumar, sir. Good afternoon, sir. My question is exam pressure and losing out on sleep. How does that affect the mental well-being of students? So you are muted.
Good afternoon. Before coming to that question, I have certain observations to make. Somebody was talking about self-diagnosis. We should not actually do self-diagnosis. We should be only aware what are all the changes which we are undergoing biologically, thought-wise, behavior-wise, cognition-wise. A diagnosis is to be done only by a clinician. You go to a professional, maybe a mental health professional or a medical professional, he can or she can only actually do the diagnosis. So self-diagnosis, she may not have meant it actually to be just like that, but these things actually matters. So there is no self-diagnosis. It should be self-awareness, one. Second is that identify your changes, which I was keep telling. Look into the biopsychosocial perspective. There is actually the genesis goes in 1970s when a physician called George Angel actually looked into patients who used to come to him for certain ailments. They used to only look into the biological paradigm, but not looking at actually the psychological and social paradigm. So here, actually, my point is that all these three are interconnected. If there is a change in biological domain, that is a sleep. Sleep is a biological domain. If you don't sleep, definitely you will have an irritability. That is a psychological domain. And maybe on the other domain, the interaction, the social domain is that you don't want to interact, or you may be actually showing some outburst. That is a behavioral domain. So all these things are interconnected. So the sleeplessness brings in impact on, holistically on a person. So that is what actually I want to say. These two messages I want to say that. And to your question, I think Dr. Balashanti will answer, then I will supplement her.
Okay. So exam pressure and sleeplessness, isn't it? So there are a lot of ways to enhance your preparation for exams. No, I'm sure there are very good reading habits that teachers would have taught you, or the internet itself would give you a lot of tips on good, successful reading habits, which are very, very important for inculcating. And as a practice, once you start it, as a habit, once you start it, as you grow up in each and every grade, and as you pass through your college or higher degrees or post-graduation later, these things should stick with you. So learning habits are very, very important. They say well prepared is half done, isn't it? So once you start preparation from day one, it eases your stress levels. Rather than preparing on the 11th hour, if you have an exam tomorrow morning, if you start preparing this evening, it's going to be very, very difficult, and the stress is just going to add up. So if you're going to do that continuously for one full week for your entire set of exams, imagine the kind of burnout that you would be having. So this would definitely hinder your sleep pattern, and you are definitely going to have insomnia, diagnosed insomnia, or at least, like somebody said, being aware of the symptoms of insomnia which is inside you. So once it starts, for every related stressor, it doesn't have to be only exams. Later in life, when you have issues with relationship, when you have a job loss, when you are suffering from an illness, when there are other losses that, God forbid, you don't have to face, but in case you face, the stressors would add up, and you will start coping the same way. Okay? So,
I think
thank you. Okay, so it is important for you not to tie up this issue of sleeplessness, or this issue of sleep disruption and any stressor. Okay, so once you start off with exams, there is a possibility that this is going to continue with you lifelong. So break the chain now. Break the chain now. See how you can prepare well for an exam, well in advance, right from day one, using effective study habits. That will help you not to get stressed out in the 11th hour and then finally have sleep problems. Okay? Yeah.
Yeah, and use your bed only for sleep. Don't use your bed for reading in the night, or use your mobile phone or your smartwatch. So that is also there. And somewhere actually you need to put a cap that before you sleep 1 or 2 hours before, you have to stop reading all those things actually. That many people tend to go to bed and start reading till I'll sleep. Or actually that don't indulge in any of that stimulating sort of an activities that like watching TV. And today we are actually watching the screen. And you know one thing, why we call it as a digital addiction, if somebody takes an alcohol or smokes a cigarette, the particular brain part is getting flickered by this substance. And the same thing actually happens when we overlook at actually the screen, the same part is actually getting flickered. So that is why we call it as a digital addiction. So we need to actually have it. And importantly, the physical activities actually, but I won't say actually that some people are actually good at reading in the morning. Some people are night owls. But whatever it is actually that, you should have minimum 6 to 8 hours of sleep as a regular sort of a pattern, in spite of you are having exam or whatever it is. And this anxiety of examination preparation, of course, all of us actually will have certain amount of anxiety. It is not distress, stress. At times, actually, stress is also good for us. So it actually, which propels us, which motivates us actually to go and do certain particular tasks, complete certain tasks. So let us not actually take everything is actually into a negative sort of a thing. Only thing is that you need to have a sort of a regular pattern in reading, regular pattern in sleeping, regular pattern in doing your things, which is actually there in the pandemic is getting affected. So that is where actually the people, and importantly that not comparing others. If somebody else is sleeping for only 4 hours, reading for 8 hours, I'm not reading much. I'm sleeping more and I'm not actually, so less sleep, too much of study when comparing with others is also actually going to have large amount of stress. So let us not compare. Each one is individual, is unique. Each one's biological makeup is unique. Their requirements are unique. The cognitive ability is unique. So let us actually keep to ourselves, not comparing with our neighbor, our friends, or somebody else, something. This is actually very, very important. And today's children are actually that he is studying 8 hours, he is studying 15 hours, he is not going out, he is not sleeping, I am sleeping more. So parents also compare, children themselves also compare. So let us not compare these things with others.
Thank you. Now I'll hand it over to Sahani ji.
Yes, thank you, Sanja. My question is for Shefali, ma'am. Ma'am, how has overcoming insomnia helped you to become stronger as a person? Ma'am, you're muted.
It has really helped me so in taking my decisions personally, professionally, and earlier when out of stress, I used to do everything in perfection. I never used to do it. I never was able to do everything perfectly. However, when I started sleeping nicely and taking proper sleep, and now I can see the difference that I can make better decisions, and I am more polite to my friends, family, and the colleagues, and I am very quick and agile now, and I do better work in comparison to what I used to do earlier when I couldn't sleep at all. So a lot of positive changes I could see in myself. Anything else? I hope I answered it.
Thank you for your answer, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, children. You had some wonderful questions to ask our panelists. Veera, ma'am.
Thank you so much. I have been hearing everybody for the last 1 hour, and it has been very, very enlightening hearing everybody, you know. First of all, I would like to thank the panelists, you know, for taking out time to address the students on such an important topic, because I think this problem is something which is very common in adolescents, that this is something we need to understand. You know, Manveer ma'am is not there, but she did share a lot of symptoms. So now you're aware of the kind of, if you are facing anything like that, then please, as told by them, don't go for self-diagnosis, huh? Consult a doctor who will treat you in that, huh? And Jay Kumar sir and his associate was sharing how sleeplessness impacts the overall well-being of a person with special focus in the pandemic times. And Shefali ma'am, especially for sharing her story and how, you know, it impacted her personal and professional life, and how having worked upon it, you know. So if you are having this kind of sleeplessness or insomnia, it is important to consult a doctor, treat it. The reasons could vary. We also discussed the different reasons. It could be relating to stress, it could be relating to food habits, as Jacobasa said, or, you know, anxiety, or, you know, increased screen time. There are many reasons, but one needs to understand the reason and then work upon it and how to go about it. So at the same time, you know, there was this question of how many hours of sleep is very important. So 6 hours, 7 hours, And I think Jay Kumar sir said, don't compare with others. You know, what is important is even that 3 hours of sleep or 4 hours of sleep, our very own Prime Minister, you know, sleeps for just 4 hours, but still he manages to do it. Modi ji does it. Why? Because then whatever 4 hours sleep he has a good full sleep, you know, a complete sleep, not a disturbed one. And then he does not exhibit those symptoms that Manveer ma'am shared. So even if you're having 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours or 6 hours, if you're not showing those symptoms, then you are having your own sleep pattern. Everybody has their own sleep patterns. Everybody has their own way of mechanisms. But if you're not able to cope with it, then, you know, something very interesting. I would like to make a personal confession of my sleep experience over here. You know, when my son was till middle school, you know, I looked after his academics and would make him sleep by 10 o'clock and, you know, had a pattern. But the moment he entered into high school, his sleeping pattern changed. Now he would wake up late at night. He would wake and I would have sleeplessness. So, you know, so I started developing that insomnia. I was really worried whether he's studying at night, whether he's not studying at night. I hope he's not watching TV. So I started sleeping in his room while he was studying. With lights on, he would study while I was sleep in that room, you know, even with lights on. But I had a good night's sleep. So at least I was sure that he's not watching me. So I did it for 2-3 months and I realized, okay, now he's studying. Now I can go home. I can go to my room and sleep. So people say that you have to switch off your lights, switch off your TV, read a book. You know, but if you have any stress, then I think it is more to do with your stress, that you have to manage that stress to do it. So I think it's a very good discussion and something which is very important, which not all of us exist. So my many, many congratulations to the Nindya YP team of Push Bihar for taking up this topic and organizing this panel discussion with such a good team of panelists. And thank you, Principal Ma'am, Amitamon Ma'am, and the Sonali coordinator, Shalini Ma'am, everybody for being there, and the team for such good questions. And raising such good questions, and for the panelists for taking out time and motivating and inspiring the kids how to handle this insomnia problem. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Veera. Thank you so much. And I think heartful gratitude to all our panelists. Team Nindya, you're doing great. Veera ma'am has been saying this to all the teams, but I'm sure I can see that smile and gleam in her eyes that you're far ahead of other teams, right, Veera ma'am?
No, this is very good. It was very informative for me too. Huh?
Yeah.
Every time I meet a YP team, I take back a lot of knowledge, information and wisdom.
I know. It was really encouraging to hear panelists, all of them. You spoke from your heart, and I think the children... If this message can spread across to everybody, we couldn't have all this whole school to listen to this. But if the message can pass across through my team Nindya, it will be great.
Thank you very much for